Welcome to the next section of the DFS video, where we're going to actually learn to control the system. You're probably going to be better off getting a copy of the DFS user guide. I think I've got a link on the site. Going through this will teach you a lot of the finer stuff that I won't actually go through here, but we've got some 3.5-inch PC drives, so when you're hearing whirring noises, these are what's making the noise. As you saw in the hardware video, we've got the eBay from Steve Picton, the adapter, which allows me to hook these up easily to the Beeb. And on here we've got the early Acorn Soft disk controller chip, and that's backed up by also the 0.9 DFS chip in this machine. So this is standard Acorn DFS, as you can read. Bog standard as it came. Now we're going to invest the time in learning the DFS, because this is basically the foundations on what much of the other later stuff is built. So once you've got to grips with this, then you can step forward more easily. So I'm going to bring you into the screen and let's go forward. Okay, here we go. This is, as you can see, it's a BBC computer. It's got the standard Acorn DFS in it. That's what this wording is telling you. There is a way to find out what's going on inside a machine without taking the cover off, and that's by issuing the star help command. You can see that we've got a DFS 0.9, that's the standard disk filing system. We've got another DFS in here, 0.A1, and that's the DFS that is used to handle the MMC card system. Because this one didn't come with the floppy tools, I've had to go out and buy an ADT chip, the Advanced Disk Toolkit chip. This has got some extra stuff on it, like the format command. And also we have the operating system version 1.20, which is pretty much standard. We can ask for more details on this by typing star help and the command, in this case star ADT. I want to know more about the ADT system. All the commands have just suddenly run up the screen in front of us, so I need to slow them down. So what I'm going to do now is hold control down while I press the letter N for November. Now that I've pressed control N, if I ask for the same thing again, I've engaged scroll mode. So you can see that this is going to sit there until I press the shift button to go to the next page. And it will continue with that until we're finished. To switch it off, you just use Control O, and that turns page mode off. But using that, you can see details about the commands. And as you can see with this ADT, you've got a lot of extra commands coming in here. But, right, let's go to the basics. If you want to find out what's on a disk, you issue the star catalog command, star cat. That will tell you what's on the drive. StarCat is commonly referred to by its shortcut, which is an asterisk with a full stop, star dot. That will do the same job. You can see here the basic structure of information is you have the header, which contains the drive, in this case 0, the current directory you're looking in, the library you're looking at, and the option that's going to happen to the Pling boot. We have a number of files, and you can see that they've got other files here with letters in front. Now, directories on the BBC are different to directories on the PC. Directories here consist of a single letter, and every file has a directory. A letter or character, there are only a few characters that you can't use as directory delimiters, and those are in the DFS guide. I'll leave you to look at the fine detail. Because we are in directory $, which is the default directory, and these files are in directory $, they appear at the top of the list. We have these files, which are in directory A, C, B, and D. If I use star dir to change the directory to directory A, and then ask for a catalog, you can see the difference. We are now in directory A, my prog shows up, and all the other files are now listed with their $ prefix. So you can see what's going on there. If I go back to directory star dir $, would help if I hit the shift key, you could see that we've gone back to before. Our directory is $, and there's the files as before. The library is similar to the path. If we issued a star command and it's not in the ROMs, it would look to the disk's file system for the command. And in this case, it would look in the library dollar. Let's say I wanted to issue the command star myprog, and I wanted to run this one here, b.myprog. What I'd use is star lib b. Our directory is again, and you can see that although we're still in directory dollar with all the files, our library is now set to b. So if I issued the star myprog command, this is the one that it would run, the one that is in directory b, because that's the library in which it's been told to search, and that's how it would run. I could, of course, say star run b.myprog, and that would also have the same effect, and that would also run the same program. Ultimately, you have the address. If I clear the screen here, you can address a file by star run its drive number, its drive number followed by its directory number or character, and by the file name. That would be a complete address. The drive letter is drive number is here. I could replace that with 1, 2, or 3. I could replace that with any other directory character and the file name. Note also in DFS that file names are only 7 characters long. 7 characters is your maximum. That does create a bit of confusion with tapes, where some of them are 8 characters. So if you're transferring files from tape to disk, that's one thing to be aware of. But what about this option 3? And what is the Pling boot file? Well, when you press shift down, when you press break, you cause a boot sequence. That makes the system look at the drive, read this option, and execute that option on Pling boot. And if I switch to drive 1 here, we can see a little bit more detail of what's going on. You have a number of options. 0 is off, so when you pressed shift break, nothing would happen. Option 1 is star load, so it would treat Pling boot as a machine code program. It would just load it into memory, but do nothing more. Option 2 is star run. That would treat Pling boot as if it was an executable machine code program, load it and run it. Or option 3 is execute. Option 3 is the most common, and because it treats Pling boot as if it is a list of commands that you would type in at the keyboard, sort of like a batch file. Now, because Pling boot isn't actually a basic program, you can't just load it into memory as you would any other basic program. You have to star list, you have to use special commands to get at it. Star list will, would help if I gave it the file name, will actually list the commands that are in there. You can see we've got CLS, DIRA, and CAT. Now, again, because it's not a basic program and it's not a machine code program, you can't chain it and you can't star run it. So what you've got to do is star execute it. So if you star execute Pling boot with these commands that are in here now, it will clear the screen, it will switch the directory here to A, and then it will give us a catalog. So we'll do that. It executes Pling boot, clears the screen, issues star DIRA, and gives us the catalog. We are now in directory A, and we've got a catalog. And because Pling boot is in the default directory, we've now got a dollar in front of it. So that's all well and good, but how do you make a Pling boot? Well, first thing we're going to do is switch our directory back to dollar, and we're going to use the star build command. Now, you haven't got to use Pling boot, you can use any other file name for this, and you can execute them pretty much the same way. So we can say, okay, star dir b, star dot, star dir dollar, star dot, and then we press the escape key to finish it. Right, Now, we're just going to clear the screen and we're going to start execute plain boot. And what we get is it switches to directory B and gives us a directory, switches to directory $ and gives us a directory. So it's executed those commands just like we'd type them in the keyboard. So there you go. You have options, and I'm just going to look up the options as I'm talking. You have the *exec* *exec* to execute a file. You have the *list* to show you what's in the file, and you can use the *build* command to make such a file. Right, here we are. It's one of the *option* commands, and *opt* 4 space and whatever number. So if we asked for *opt* 4-3, that would change it. We'll ask for a directory. You'll now see that it's changed to option 3 execute. But we could ask you *opt* 4-2. Whoops, I can't spell. *opt* 4-2. Now it's changed to run. *opt* 4-1. Now it's changed to load. And we can issue *opt* 4-0, and that has changed it back to off. And this will operate on the drive which you are currently looking at. You can find out information on files by using something like the *info* command. We're going to ask for *info* on, let's say, defend. Here it is. We have the file name. If it was locked, we'd see an L here, and we'll go through that. We then have the load address where it would load into memory if it was a machine code program, where it would execute from, its length in bytes, so it's only 8C7 bytes, and its start sector on the disk. So you're getting that all the information you need just by info, *info. You can use *access, and that will toggle the lock. If I now ask for *info again, we get, or we should get, the lock. And that has actually not worked. We can use *access to turn the lock on or off. Without an L at the end of it, it will clear the lock. With an L, it will lock it. So it's now done that. We'll ask for info again, and we can now see that we've got the L here. What this means is the file's locked. If we attempted to write over it or attempt any write operation on it or to delete it, it would refuse us, saying it's locked, and that's it. So if we issued access defend without the L, then what that would do is the lock has now cleared. One interesting thing that I'm just going to find out while we're here is that if we do a lock and we do a *catalog, yes, you can see during the catalog there's an L column, and that is locked, and you can see the fact that the file is locked in a standard catalog operation. Now I'm going to take a quick look at the copy command, *copy. Now, one thing that you can't easily do in this is copy on the same drive a file of one name to a file of another name. So if you wanted to make a backup of something before you changed it, you'd have to copy it from one drive to another, say drive 2 for example, and you give the source drive, the destination drive, and the file name, def32 for example, and that will copy from drive 0 to drive 2. You can rename a file, obviously, but the one thing you can't easily do is make a copy of the same file on the same surface. I would now have to go switch into drive 2, which would be *drive2. I would have to issue a rename command, rename def32, def34, and then I would have to run a copy from 2 to 0, def 2-4, and that would then copy the file back onto drive 0, and then we would have two copies of the file on there. So we'd have 3.2 and 2.4. That's pretty much the only way that I've found to easily do it. One thing you need to be aware of is when you're using the star copy command is that it uses the computer's memory to load chunks of the file before it writes them out. So if you've got any program in memory, save it before you start copying files around, because otherwise you could find them gone. A classic example here is if I did a copy from 0 to 0 to def2.4. Now, this has a system to enable you to copy from one drive to another if you only have the one physical drive. So this is going to say, okay, copying from drive 0 to drive 0, insert the source disk. So we'd insert the source, it would copy a chunk to memory, we'd swap it with the destination disk, then we'd hit a key, and out it would go. Insert the source disk again, and then it's happy. If the file is larger than the computer's memory, it will do this in chunks. So be aware. The other thing that you need to do is be aware of the star compact. With most modern file systems, they can take care of defragmentation. This can't. So you need to issue the star compact command every now and then to make sure that everything is organized into properly sequential sectors. That should leave you enough room for everything else to go in and to be used freely. There's a couple more commands I'm going to go into here. One is star enable. There are some commands which are so destructive that they will require you to type star enable before they'll run. So if you type a command and it says not enabled, you need to type star enable before you run it, and then it'll work. The other one is one of the tools. It's not on the DFS itself, but it's on the ADT, and it's star free. That will show you what's going on. We have 20 files, so many sectors, so many bytes free, 11 files, 63 sectors, sorry, that's actually hexadecimal, not denary, 25,000 bytes used. So if you see star dot, we've got 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. And this is because there's another, because the disk has only got the first two sectors, which are given over to the catalog, there are limits on the catalog itself. One of them is that you're limited to 31 files on the surface of the drive with the standard disk filing system. This changes as the disk filing systems change, but for the most basic one, the standard DFS, you're limited to 31 files. So there you are. That's a basic introduction to the main commands of the disk filing system. This one's pretty much the first one that came out. But there really is no excuse for not getting hold of this, because it is readily available on the internet if you didn't get a copy with the Beeb that you bought. Practice it, because it's certainly got its own foibles, and it's quite different to many of the filing systems that we're used to in the modern day, and in many cases we take for granted. So learning the limitations is very much part of this, and once you've got the DFS itself cracked and how it works, that will stand you in good stead for the next filing systems as we start going up the chain.